correct. Our first panel is marketing and contract opportunities. So, you know, what are buyers looking for? You know, what contracts are out there? So don't forget, write your questions down, and John and Nate will be walking through and collecting those, and then we'll ask some questions. So who would like to go first? Have any, Chris, you want to go first? Okay. All right. So Chris Neff. Chris is an organic grain merchandiser, and he's from Perdue.
Morning, everybody. Once again, my name is Chris Neff. I'm with Perdue Agribusiness. I'm an organic grain merchandiser. I've been with Perdue for about 2 years now. Perdue's been actually an organic, Perdue Agribusiness has, since 2011, but really got started getting into the more farmer origination side since late 2013. And then want to start this off by saying Perdue wants your organic grains. While there's a lot of producers that we may have not contacted yet or may not know that Perdue is taking organic grain, we wanted to kind of go about this at kind of like a cautious pace. Our use for organic feed ingredients is very large, and if we tackled this at too heavy of a pace, we didn't want to get into a situation where we couldn't take delivery of all products when they needed to take delivery. And the reason for that would be, when we first started, we didn't have the infrastructure in our part that we do today. When we started, we only had 2 delivery points up in Southeast Pennsylvania. Now I'm happy to announce that we've expanded to 4 delivery points, and as well as 2 more delivery points here on the Eastern Shore. So that makes a much better opportunity for those of you that are local around here. We're still growing all the time. A big part of what I want to do to grow this farmer base is we have myself that's originating the U.S. farmer grain. We also have a team of on the ag input side. They're addressing agronomy issues, seed, fertilizer, and anything else that may need to be addressed on the input side. So we're trying to build that complete supply chain from start to finish. That way, we're not just saying, you know, hey, we'd like your acres, and then not have some solutions on the front end, because lots of you call me, have some questions on, you know, what's the best seed to buy and everything. I may not necessarily have those answers, but I can surely point you to one of us on the team that does. We contract old and new crop grains. We're never really not contracting grain at any point. We have lots of room. We have lots of capacity now. So old crop, definitely. New crop, definitely. New crop a couple years out, definitely. The different types of grain that we take, that we use for our own feed, are corn, beans, and wheat. Of course, those are probably the main crops that most of you would be producing, but I know a lot of you, per your growing conditions in your soil, are looking into grains such as canola, barley, milo. While we may not use those, I'm definitely going to do what I can to find a market for those for you, because, like I said, we're trying to build that domestic base. We're trying to build that because I can sleep much better at night knowing that I can drive down the road to your farm and see that grain growing in the field. Basically, if you'd like to contract some grain with Perdue, it's a very simple process. First of all, I'm going to ask for your organic certificate. Of course, your organic certificate, need to renew that once every year. We just ask to get a copy of that before you can contract some grain. But with the big influx of organic farmers wanting to get certified for the first time recently, it's been hard to get that certificate current once it expires. In that case, a letter of good standing with your certifier saying that you are still within compliance would suffice until we can get said certificate. Next step is we need to make sure you can meet the specs for our organic grain. Two of the main ones is unfortunately, we do not have any drying capacity at any of our elevators. So we have maximum moistures. I know that may limit some guys that don't have too much storage, but that's where we are at right now. We also have maximum, we test every load for GMO contamination. So that GMO level is 5%. So anything above that, we will not be able to take. That is our limit, and we test every single farm load. We have that label on the store shelf, so we like to maintain that and make sure we can have some backing behind that. Different kinds of contracts. We do flat price contracts, and then these contracts are on a volume base. There's other types of contracts that include acreage contracts. We're not at that point yet to do an acreage contract, mainly because we're trying to build that full supply chain from start to finish on the agronomy side and on the grain purchasing side. We also do picked up off farm, and then we can contract for delivered loads. As far as scheduling loads go, just another simple process, place a call to me. I'm a very busy guy, can't always get to your call right away, but definitely call me, keep calling back, reach me. 1 week in advance for scheduling loads is what I request. Sometimes we can get it done next day, 2 days, but we do have a large volume coming in, and it takes a lot to schedule all that, so definitely get a hold of us as soon as possible. And then biggest thing for you guys, payment. Average payment length when bringing in some loads is 7 to 10 days or so. But we have a new system put in place at the elevators and feed mills that automatically kicks out a check next day or the day after. So payment going forward is going to be much, much quicker for those of you who have contracted with us. Basically, I guess that's kind of what I was here to give you guys. And in conclusion, Perdue organically on the grain side is continuously growing. Not only is the demand for our feed ingredients for the feed growing, but our contacts and contact base is always growing. So if not only are we needing it for our feed, but we're building contacts for sales outside. So it's much easier for us to move grain than it ever has been in the past. And once again, there's a big advantage to having that grain grown domestically. I was hired on with Perdue to be the domestic procurement manager. So I'm here for the U.S. farmer to grow that base so we don't have the need to bring in stuff from other countries on boats. Biggest part I want to advertise today is that complete supply chain. Where in the past, not too many organic farmers have had anybody to give them advice on what seed to plant, what fertilizer works best in my soil, what crop rotation do I need. That is a very important part of it, and that's what's going to help me to get to the point where I can get contract acres with you guys, because it's a very important part that I know what kind of production might happen in a year. So we have people on that end that can help you as well. So any part in the supply chain, by all means, we can get you an answer for that. And we have, being Perdue to start on the conventional side, we have a very good presence on the Eastern Shore and on the Mid-Atlantic coast. So we have that relationship and supply chain built as far as logistics already to make this a much smoother process to get the off-farm loads going and to promote domestic growth within the United States. So I guess with that, that's really all I have. So.
Volunteers for next? Okay. All right. So Terry Ingram, he's from Organic Valley, and you're going to talk a little bit about dairy, vegetables, and grains, so lots of different things. So
I'm Terry Ingram from Organic Valley. Jenny is sitting behind me, which makes me a little nervous, but I do have on green socks, so I'm good. So it's nice to be south of the Mason-Dixon line for a Virginia boy. And predominantly my farmers are Amish, so it's nice to see this room. I don't see any Amish men in here. I love working with Amish farmers, but it's so refreshing for me to go somewhere where I'm not just in a room exclusively with Amish farmers. I had an opportunity to speak in D.C. at the National Press Club, and I was in Lancaster the day before speaking to Amish men, and they got a real kick out of the fact that I was going to Washington, D.C., and I got an even bigger laugh from the crowd in Washington, D.C. that I had been speaking to a group of Amish men the previous day. So I'm an organic dairy farmer from Virginia. I joined the co-op about 4 years ago and got very involved and became an employee. And it's my blessing to serve our farmers in Southeast Pennsylvania and Maryland. Organic Valley's been around for about 27 years. You probably best know us for our dairy products you see in the grocery stores. But we actually started as a small fledgling produce pool. Seven guys in Wisconsin in the 1980s, in an economy that was very similar to what we are now concerning agriculture. There were very depressed prices. They had the hindrance of high interest rates, which we don't have right now. But the opportunity for farmers in that area, for small farmers and for family farmers, was in a really tight position. These farmers came together and wrote a contract, or basically wrote a mission that they wanted to go to the marketplace with a organically produced product and ask the market to pay them a fair pay price. Those seven farmers, that business grew from just a dream. In 27 years, we just passed $1 billion in sales. We have about 1,900 members all across the country. We currently hold the largest supply of organic milk in the world. And we have just begun a relationship with members in Europe. Our mission is to serve family farms and to market organic crops grown sustainably. It's very simple. So it's very rewarding as a organic farmer to be involved with an organization like this. It's exciting to be in a room like this because, just like Ms. Fry said, it's all about opportunity. Being from Virginia, I'm a big student of history, and Thomas Jefferson in a letter to George Washington said agriculture is our wisest pursuit because it produces real wealth, good morals, and happiness. And I can tell you that all the farms I visit are generally happy farmers with smiles on their face because they are connected with the consumer base that wants farmers to live by a set of rules, and they're willing to reward them. So it's exciting to follow a sharp guy like Chris, who works for Perdue. Whoever thought that Perdue, Ms. Fry, did you think Perdue would be buying grain on the Eastern Shore when you started? I don't think you probably dreamed that would ever happen. This is a market-driven industry. And big players like Perdue are buying organic grain. We're going to see a major revolution, and you are on the vanguard, like Ms. Fry said. It's hard to add on. I really appreciated your words this morning. So that being said, for the grain farmers in the room, we have a grower pool. You can become a member, a contracted member. We will contract a portion of your grain or all of your grain. It's been really hard for us to compete on the spot market, against the spot market over the years. But with the environment now, some farmers, either for crop insurance reasons or they want to hedge part of their crops, do want to be part of a cooperative where they can have a portion of their grain contracted. We also, you do not have to be a member to participate in our trader, organic trader. You can actually use our feed department to market to other farmers in the area. You're in a wonderful position geographically to not only sell to Perdue, but there are a tremendous amount of farmers in the Lancaster area, all over Southeast Pennsylvania, you know, on up into Central Pennsylvania and Virginia to market your organic grains to. On the produce side, it's more storable products. We're looking for like winter squashes and bigger loads of produce. If you are interested in either one of those opportunities or options, you can come by my booth and I can give you a little more information on that. But like I said, we are mainly interested in connecting growers with our farmers, and we also have opportunities to become members. On the dairy side, that's more my line of expertise. We are, you know, always taking on new farmers, looking for new farmers. I'm looking to expand in the state of Maryland. We have a nice group of farmers up in the central part, or I guess in Jefferson County area. Basically, we are a farmer-run co-op, so we set our own pay price. We ask the marketplace to support that, and it's a contracted pay price, you know, that doesn't change from year to year. It's set by the board, and I can also share more details on that as well. I'll leave you with the good news. I'm sure most in this room would know that the Senate actually voted down the bill to prohibit states from labeling GMOs. I'm really excited about that, and I'm really excited just to be participating in this. We appreciate your inviting us, and I do apologize. In years past, I know we brought cheese, and so I dropped the ball on that, so don't rib me too hard for that, but I'm here to help any way I can, and we're really glad to participate. Thank you.
Thank you, Terry. Peter Miller has been at every single.
He, I think, never
missed up the cheese. I know. That's okay. But my point was that when we started this, Peter was called me and said, we want to be on board and we want to be a supporter. And thank you for being at every one of our meetings. So we certainly appreciate that. Okay, next. Okay. So next is Kim Bartosh. He is with Hanover Foods, and he has an organic vegetable program. So, Ken, thank you.
Thanks. Good morning, everyone. My name is Ken Bartosh. I'm from Hanover Foods. I'm the director of agriculture there. I've been with Hanover 27 years, and I've actually been in the food vegetable processing business for 36 years. So Hanover's a very family regionally based company. We're out of Hanover, Pennsylvania. We grow crops on the Eastern Shore, Pennsylvania, New York, primarily just vegetable processing. We do frozen and canned goods. Hanover's been in business for 92 years, so we're well established here in the Eastern region. We distribute products from New England down through the eastern coast all the way down to Florida, and we probably go as far west as the Mississippi River. We do some special contracts with other regionally and nationally known accounts across the country, but primarily for this endeavor for organic, it's going to be products that we process in our locations in Ridgely, Maryland, Clayton, Delaware, or State College, Pennsylvania. We have 13 processing facilities that do a variety of things. We do canned goods also, just so you know. We do snack foods, fresh foods, refrigerated products. And with the impact on organic in recent years, Hanover's really been kind of behind the scenes just trying to figure out what we wanted to do. With now all the competition in organic, in frozen vegetables on the shelf, Hanover is actually looking to initiate their own label and their own brand for some organic goods. So last year was the first year that Hanover actually produced organic vegetables on the Eastern Shore, and I think just about all the guys that grew for us last year are here, and I really appreciate that effort. And when we started, we did 150 acres of sweet peas, and we did about 10 acres of green beans. This year, we're going to have around 220 acres of sweet peas and 80 acres of green beans. And for us, the real push has been, we've had requests for in excess of, I don't know, 8 to 10 years to do something, but it's always been a case that the customer was never really interested in paying the price for organic. Now, as that seems to have changed, it's allowed us to go to growers and find growers that are able to do the work and provide the crops for us, and we can go out there with a price that certainly can meet their needs, and then the customer is willing to pay. Peas and green beans seem to fit well here on the Eastern Shore. It's new as an item, but as we learn more about it and we get more experience, we seem that we have the applications here to do it, and we certainly can provide the resources to harvest and help manage the crop along the way. So from that standpoint, we're very much interested in doing it, and really appreciate all the effort and interest that we've gotten here in the last year and a half. Support that we have for growing this product primarily has been through our own field reps. We have a gentleman here that runs the Eastern Shore program. His name is Justin Price-Stocko. He couldn't be here today, but he basically manages nearly 15,000 acres on the Eastern Shore. And we have two gentlemen up in State College, and they manage close to 10,000 acres spread out over southern New York, north central Pennsylvania. And actually, they're going to be down here helping with the green bean program, since green beans are primarily processed up in State College. I don't want to get into specifics of contracting. I can talk to anybody individually after I'm finished here today if you have interest. We do provide the harvest aspect. I think I mentioned that briefly, since we want control of that part of the process. And as I indicated, it's new to Hanover. It's a new endeavor, but we really think that we can make it, because there is really getting less and less interest in anything but domestically grown vegetables. And the fact that we can do it here in an area that we're familiar with and have access to, it really has helped us to gain a little bit of a foothold, even though we're going into our second year of production. So if there's particular questions after this morning's little discussion, I'd be happy to sit with anybody and go over those details. And you know, that's pretty much our story. So thank you.
Okay, there's two of you. They're discussing who's going next. Steve, you're going to go next? So Steve Cameron is here from Coleman Natural, and Steve is a broiler grow out manager. So thanks, Steve.
I'll let Spencer squirm for another 10 minutes or so. We talk about St. Patty's Day, and I'll tell you this. My son, he told me last week, said, Dad, don't forget to wear green on St. Patrick's Day. And I reminded him, I said, son, I'm organic. I'm green all the time. So, but a little bit about myself. As you know, Coleman is owned by Perdue, which is a good relationship. I spent 27 years with Perdue on the conventional side of the business. I had the opportunity about a year and a half, 2 years ago, to step into the organic side. Probably the best thing I've ever done. So truly enjoy it. Went for years working with people to grow chickens, more on the commodity side, the branded side, the veggie side, as we continue to move Perdue up the pyramid. And about 5 years ago, as Jim Perdue said, I mean, they have a company vision of getting up that pyramid. At the top of the pyramid sits organic. And we had the golden opportunity then to buy Coleman Foods, and that's what we did. So that put us in that realm to find that customer base. It gives us the relationship with Perdue and agribusiness to sustain that business, just because we got all that access to organic grain. So it's been a good marriage of the two. We maintain the Coleman brand because it's recognized as a good brand for organic poultry. Where is Coleman? Why are we here on the shore? We started out, I mean, we acquired operations in Petaluma, California, Draper Valley, which is located out in Washington State, and we had BC Natural up in Pennsylvania. We closed the plant up there a couple years ago, and we'd already started processing birds from Pennsylvania into our Milford, Delaware facility. With that being said, we maintain about 7 million square feet of production in the state of Pennsylvania. Our plan is to eventually fill up the Milford plant, which can do about 1.15, 1.2 million birds a week of organic product. We plan to backfill that through local production. With that being said, I also, as Jenny said, I'm the grow out manager, but I also do the housing portion of it as well. So if anybody has any interest in housing, retrofitting, I'm available after the panel here. But like I said, I mean, we've got, last year at this time, I can tell you that we had 300,000 square feet of capacity growing organic birds on the shore. As of today, we have a 1.4 million. So our goal is, like I said, is 4.5 million. With new houses we've got in the works, we've still got room for about another million to a million and a half of new houses or retrofits. So it's growing very well. It's been very well perceived. And like I said, it's been very interesting to me. I like what I do. I get up every morning enjoying what I get to do. What makes it so important and special to me is the people that I get to do business with. What I notice about the organics, when I look at talking to certifiers, when I look at talking to people in the business, there's a higher level of integrity that does not exist on the conventional side of poultry. It's refreshing to me. It's who I like to do business with. So, and again, I get to pick and choose being in my position. So, again, everybody needs a choice, and I enjoy having that choice. But like I said, I'm a bad salesman, and I've always told people over years, I cannot sell you anything that I wouldn't buy myself. And that's what I like about organic production. Do I eat organic? I would love to eat organic. I can't, it's not part of my budget. Given the choice of it, I'll eat organic. I never was scared of eating regular chicken. I see how regular chicken's grown. I see how organic chickens are grown. I see how we process. I see the food safety we put into it. So either one doesn't scare me. But how we get to grow an organic bird, the husbandry we can put into it, the housing that we have, the fact that, if they want to go outside, they can. We just put them in a more healthier environment. That's the part of it that I like. So I hope, be able to answer questions afterwards or when I finish here. But like I said, I appreciate Jenny asking me to come today, and I'll leave it over to Spencer. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. All right. Spencer Miller is here from, and he's the organic grain manager at Boyd Station, LLC. Thanks, Spencer.
You know the saying about best for last? Well, I don't promise it, but we'll do as good as I can. Good morning, everyone. My name's Spencer Miller. I'm gonna bring this up a little. There you go. I'm with Boyd Station. We are in Danville, Pennsylvania. And before I get started, I wanna thank Jenny for the invite to speak today. And also, where's Bill Mason? Is he in here? There he is in the back. I wanna thank Bill. He kind of talked to Jenny, who talked to me, so appreciate that. Been working with Bill, and we need to talk later. We've done a lot of business, but never actually met in person, so today's the day. How many organic soybean farmers do we have out in the crowd today? One, two, three. All right. Go ahead and stop by my booth later on, and I'd love to talk to you, if we already do business or if not. Talk about some opportunities for organic soybeans. And I'm already getting off track, so I want to get back on. Like I said, I'm with Boyd Station. We're a soybean, organic soybean processor up in central Pennsylvania, up in the hills. We make a high pro organic soy meal. It's a 47.5% protein meal. Something else we do is we actually dehull the bean, which is kind of unique to the industry. There's not a lot of processors doing that. So we have the soy meal, the soy hulls, and then of course the organic oil also that we make. I specifically am on the purchasing side, working directly with domestic organic soybean farmers all over the Midwest and the Mid-Atlantic area. We've kind of gone, the reason I came on board was to go direct to the farm. We have an industry that's flagged down with a lot of middlemen who really don't add a lot of value to the process. Being the end user, now we tend to be able to give the best price at the farm gate for the farmer. So it's been a nice setup for that. And our primary focus is domestic organic soybeans. We will try to procure as many as possible early on in the year to line up our supply chain. We've been asked by a lot of our larger customers that we make that a priority, and that's what we do. One thing I actually have developed, or we've worked on at Boyd, is we've developed an acreage program that we offer at the beginning of every new year, and generally try to wrap that up at the end of March. And what that is a program for organic beans so that we can get farmers to dedicate acres, and it's not a guarantee of bushels early on that come into our facility. And farmers liked it. We've seen a lot of positive response because, especially in organic, but in any commodities, of course, you don't know yields down the road or, act of God, disasters. Anything can happen. So it's kind of a low-risk contract. We try to set the price where we see the price going for the fall at a more competitively price to get the farmers to commit earlier so we can line up our supply chain for domestic production, which, like I said, is our priority. Unfortunately, we process over 1 million bushel a year currently. That's expected to, well, it's not unfortunate. The unfortunate part is, yes, we do run short, and we will bring in South American beans from South America, but that is the only other country that we will use. We'd like to get to a point where we don't have to do that, but the acres aren't there, and the availability and the competition for those acres of domestic beans aren't there right now in the state. But hopefully with our program and sustainable pricing, we can go that way. That's another reason why we developed this program, for long-term working relationships, giving farmers, domestic farmers, a sustainable price so they can keep their business going, so we can keep our business going. So it's been a good relationship as far as that goes, working directly with the farm. Me personally, on the organic side, the reason I tell guys I like organic, the idea of it, organic farming has saved a lot of small family farms. When we're moving more towards a get big or get out agriculture, especially up in Pennsylvania, you have a lot of small 30, 40 head dairy farms that have been able to stay around because of the niche market in organic and have been able to keep the farm. And I like that, supporting those guys. So I guess I would say I'm thankful that we have a market in organic that can keep that going for the little guy, who can't milk 600 head of dairy cow, which is the way the conventional side is going. And it's the same on the grain side. The average farm we work with is 100 acres or less. But as I say to the guys, one truck at a time. So that's how we bring in the beans and use them. We use a lot of Midwest beans we bring in on rail. If you're in the Mid-Atlantic region, which I'm assuming everyone is here today, it would be all picked up on the farm. We offer those services and handle the freight. Feel free to give me a call. Like I said, stop by the booth, please, when we go out there. And if I'm missing anything, I'm missing. So appreciate it. Thanks for the time today. And I look forward to speaking to you.
Okay, so you've heard about all the opportunities out there that are here on really in our Mid-Atlantic region. So I've got some questions for you gentlemen. Let's see, where shall I start? Maybe I'll start with this one. This question is for Chris. What is the procedure if your GMO analysis is above the 5% threshold, and about other legitimate analyses that are done? Do you accept, and then I guess kind of what is your procedure for the GMO testing?
Up until this year, there had never really been a procedure because there basically had never had to be because we'd never had a problem with GMO contamination. Lately there has been, and I'm working on putting together a set procedure because, like I had said, basically, the only other alternative was to find another home for it, destination, another organic market close by. But there has never been a guarantee of that market close by. So when that didn't work, it would have been a have to come back home. And not all farms are set up to maybe take a load back off of a truck when that situation occurs. So we're definitely putting something like that together for sure. Our testing procedures, as far as that goes, we use Envirologics, the strip scan test. It's 9 different strips that test for different GMO traits. Your Roundup Ready, your rootworm, I don't know of all of them off the top of my head, but it tests down to the 100th of a percentage, and basically we add those together, whether it be 4 different traits that test positive or 1, and then if it's at or below, or if it's at or below 5%, we accept. But anything over that, we have to go to an alternative destination. So.
Okay. Now, Spencer, do you do testing?
I've been known to start rapping when I have a mic this close to my mouth. So. We do. Every single load, we use the same program that Perdue, the Envirologics comb test with beans. It's Roundup Ready and your Liberty Link. Every single load is tested. I'll be honest, we have very few issues on the bean side because we're testing for less traits. I've heard the corn can be a lot harder because you're testing for obviously a lot more traits. We've had probably in the last year that I can think of off the top of my head, we might have had a couple trucks and I remember a couple rail cars being rejected for GMO. So it doesn't tend to be an issue for us. And our cutoff is actually more stringent than what non-GMO project asks for. Our cutoff is 0.9% GMO. So, you know, almost 1%. But
so where do you think the GMO contamination is coming from? Or what do you see?
Usually we've found on the rail cart side, a lot of it is conventional loaded cars that aren't cleaned properly. It could be a truck, which is why we have a, you know, stringent washout procedure on truckloads. But as far as the corn goes, it's cross-pollination with, you know, 95% of the crop in the U.S. is GMO crop.
Right.
And especially when you try to pull stuff from the Midwest, boy, look out. I mean, that's, you know, that's GMO land. And actually, you know, some of these other countries that some of these other users are pulling from, like India, you know, GMOs are outlawed. There aren't even any GMOs in India. So you have less of a chance of having any GMO contamination, which has been attractive for, you know, some people, buyers. So.
Okay. All right. While you two gentlemen are talking, how many bushels of each grain do you project to be used on Delmarva, or how much is used now? What's your projection of, you know, corn, wheat, soybeans?
As in how much, what's our use
bushels
per, over a year? Well, I guess I'll put it in a perspective of per week. We use, as far as corn, we use around 100 loads of corn, truckloads of corn per week. In the east, we use in the realm of 20 loads of wheat per week. And we use somewhere in the realm of about 40 loads of soybeans per week. So we have a pretty big use, and that's kind of where my caution with jumping into the domestic market all at once was because there wasn't that elevator storage infrastructure to take that gut slot harvest or surge protection. So we wanted to make sure that we've got that infrastructure, and it's building all the time. We have a lot more storage now, so we're working on it, and it's yeah, we have a very large demand, and like I said, we really almost don't get to the point where we can't take your grain anymore. So.
Okay, good. All right, this is, I guess, for everybody. Do any of your organizations offer any producer grants or upfront loans that may help farmers transition into organics? So we can kind of go down the line.
So we, for dairy farmers, we have a transition program where we pay $3.50 a hundredweight during the final transition years. And then we have a grant writer on staff that will work with individual farmers for a whole host of different grants. What was the third? Grants?
Grants or loans to help them transition.
Well, ours is not a loan. It's, you know, we just provide that as a member, the transitions assistance on the dairy side. We don't have anything now on the grain side, but then on the grants, we do have, I think, two grant writers to help with that.
Speaking for the vegetable side, we don't do anything like that. We've contemplated talking about it, but we're kind of a newbie in this whole process, so extremely price sensitive for us in vegetables since we're competing still with China and the markets coming in here. So but we actually think that at some point it's going to be something that's going to be more prevalent to get people to do this. So.
As far as a transition program, the extent of that kind of goes with what I said as far as we're going to try and find a market for you. Since we're still building the full supply chain from the start with the agronomy side to my end with the grain procurement and then all the way through to if you're going to grow some actual birds, it's a long process, and it's a little bit more complicated than to just simply for us pay a premium during transition and maybe receive that premium back after. So right now we're just trying to find new markets. There's a big growing demand for non-GMO grains up in Pennsylvania and New York for these up-and-coming dairies. So that's a growing market all the time, but at the same time, what complicates that is conventional grains. The prices have been so cheap. A lot of farms have tried to cut cost by growing non-GMO grains, and the market's so flooded by them that there almost doesn't need to be any sort of a premium for that whatsoever to draw a volume of it. So it's basically just the market's flooded with that. So where in years past you'd have a good premium anywhere for non-GMO grains, it's just not the case these days. So, but to put it shortly, basically, yeah, we'll try and find a market for you. By all means, contact me and we'll work on it. So,
Spencer?
Can you ask the question?
Oh, you want me to repeat the question? Okay. Wanted to know if you offer any grants or loans that help farmers transition into organics.
Okay. We don't offer any kind of loan to help transition. I have heard that this year specifically, USDA has opened up a lot more money for organic transition. So I would say your best bet is going to the USDA for that. There's more money available now than ever there has been out there for transition through the USDA. It's transitioning the way it goes is we're already directly working with the organic farmers. Boyd Station does have a conventional plant too, where some of those guys have come over who already do business with on the conventional side, but that's all been based on their decision. And for some of these guys already doing, I got a call from a farmer in Indiana yesterday, I think it was, and he was talking about 1,000 acres, changing it over, and was kind of picking my brain. And he said, he's been doing non-GMO beans for years now, so he's right on the fence, you know, of getting over there. And he said, back when we were farming with Dad as three boys, we were before organic was a thing. He called it. We were already farming organic, so we already know how to do it. We just need to get the certification now. So you have people like that who are starting to look at it, starting to look at the prices and see it's not that big of a change for them. As far as that goes, but we do not offer any money.
Steve?
Do you want to hear it from my side?
Of course. Is that one not working?
As far as for poultry housing, say if you've got an older farm you want to convert, we do offer a 5-year interest-free loan on that to cover the cost of the retrofit, which averages out to about 75 cents a square foot to retrofit a building. For new housing, like a lot of the poultry companies do, we offer $1.50 square foot sign-on bonus that you'll get right initially. It costs about $11.75 per square foot to build an organic house. So with that being said, you'll get $1.50 of it in a check when the first flock is placed. And also, we provide the same interest-free loans for new housing as well for any transition cost. So.
Okay. While you have Steve, I know with avian influenza right now we're very concerned about biosecurity, but maybe this summer do you think you'll be offering any open houses or those kind of things where people could come and look to see what?
I still plan, if you want to mark your calendars, it's looking to be probably the second week or the third week of April.
Okay.
We've kind of expanded. It'll be the first houses we've built in Cecil County. If anybody travels 213 north of Galena, you'll see them going up
So we plan to do an open house there.
Okay.
And then we'll do the proper disinfect when we get done and everything. But I think it's just it's good for the area of Cecil County to see poultry houses. I've had so many calls about what we're going to manufacture there as they've been building them, and they can't seem to understand that. But like I said, so a lot of expansion room in Cecil County. I hope. I mean, they like somebody was saying, they have very small farms, like Spencer was saying in PA, so it kind of locks us up some type with setbacks and things like that. But and Queen Anne's County has been a good county for us mm-hmm. to expand in. So. Okay. So like I said, but check the Delmarva Farmer. I'll look probably start advertising in the next couple of weeks.
Okay, good. And then also as part of today, I have an email list, an organic email list. Many of you are on it when you registered on Eventbrite. I'll have your email, so I'll make sure that I add you to my list. And whenever I get information from any of these companies, I will certainly put them out so that to help you know what's going on. I had a question. They want some quotes. They want to know what are the prices that you're offering to pay for organic grains. So just some general. I don't think anybody wants to contract anything today, but just so they get an idea.
Well, everybody wants the pricing, I guess, right? Well, I guess the pricing is really going to depend on the exact spot that you're at. But
so say they deliver it to you. Let's say they deliver it, bring it to Salisbury, or to Hurlock, I meant.
Well, in Hurlock, thing about Hurlock, that we just started at the feed mill there, so we're trying to build a comfort level to take direct off-farm loads, so we're still working on that. One place I can talk to is the south, is our mill's located across southeast Pennsylvania. And for corn, it probably somewhere delivered in the maybe $10 range, something like that. Like I said, it depends on kind of volume that comes in. Every situation depends. So I don't have a strict quote. For soybeans, it's probably our delivery location for soybeans, and I missed this in my 10 minutes earlier, that our delivery point is Pantego, North Carolina. That's our crush plant down there. So there's a little bit more freight involved with picking up, but we're right around probably that $21 range, but I mean, like I said, it depends. Please talk to me after. By all means, I'd love to hand some business cards out and build a relationship with some of you guys that are interested that I haven't talked to yet. So,
Spencer,
on the soybean side, we've been looking right now. I mean, if you're talking about pricing, this last year and a half in the organic grain market has been a little bit different. We had some really good years, and farmers made exceptionally good money on their crop. We're in one of those, it used to pay to put it in the bin up until the summer 2015. You got that midsummer rise. We didn't see that this year, even with the pricing or the crop yield not being that good the past fall. And it's expected that we're going to be in a rut again for this fall. You have on the coastline now, you have a lot of imports on both sides, west and east, that are coming in and changing the game a little bit, so to speak. But we've been working on these acreage contracts, like I said, which I think we're one of the very few companies that go out early and will take the risk. It's a risk on both sides. It's a risk as us, the buyer, to price out that early. It's a risk to the farmer in case the price would go up. But we try to offer these acreage contracts early in the year, like I said, to get committed acres into our facility. And one thing I think farmers really, it's human nature to always want the highest price, obviously, and a higher price. But to be sustainable on your farm, you really have to look. You should go off your cost of production. And I quote these prices early to farmers, and I think they look at their acres and they look at their costs, and am I going to make at least X amount of dollars? Yeah, there's always the chance that you're going to make X more. There's also the chance you're going to make X less. So we've been, for this new crop this year, we've been quoting or giving farmers a 2065 for fall crop, and that's an exact price, and that's picked up at the farm, so there's no, that's all, in the pocket to the farmer. And I think it's, you know, we do believe so far, and based on the way the market's been moving downward this year, going to be a strong number. There's been a lot of talk that organic beans feed side could be $18-$19. So we try to, again, our program is made to be sustainable for the farmer, but it also needs to be sustainable for us as far as pricing goes, or else we'll be out of business and we're no use to you at that point. So that's the bean pricing. Corn, I've been hearing new crop, you know, delivered into facilities $10. That puts you at, you know, $9-$8.50 out on the farm. But I've also heard conventional corn could be as low as $2.50 this fall, based on what happens this summer with the crop. And if that happens, you will see more downward movement even in the organic market. So, of course, it's very early now to speculate, but that's what I've been hearing.
Terry?
Yeah, so with Organic Valley, you have two avenues. One is you could contact our feed department, and they will help you try to connect with a farmer, and you sort of set your own pay price. They'll give you some guidelines. That you don't have to be a member to be a part of, to participate with that side of it. If you're looking to contract, you have to become a member, and then it's a set you know, price for a certain portion of your crop. You do have to have on-farm storage. So that I don't know, because I mainly deal with dairy, but I can get you in touch if somebody's in the room interested in doing contracting a portion or something like that. You know, definitely stop by the booth. I'll get you the information. As far as markets going, we get a lot of reports from our feed department. The last report, they were saying that there's a lot of, obviously, you know, both the fellas here have mentioned the imported grain. It looks like there's going to be a lot of bins full. It could be all the way up into new crops. So this is the first year I've seen since I've been in organics over a decade that contracting may be something worth really looking at. On the larger farmer side, the contracting has been not as competitive as, you know, what you can get on the spot market. But I think we are seeing some shift in the dynamics because of the bigger players like Perdue getting into the marketplace, which is exciting for me because it ultimately means more organic acreage. So, yeah. And if you have questions on that, please stop by my booth.
Mm-hmm. So we can't look at the Chicago Board of Trade and figure out what the price is. And I think that's what a lot, you know, conventional farmers are used to. We've got to have that relationship, you know, with our buyers. And, you know, whether you're, you know, contracting mostly acres, Spencer, you contract acres. And
yeah, I just wanted to follow up the pricing on the it's the first time, like you said, we've seen this kind of this glut in the market in a while. But that's what farming is. I mean, you save you save on the good years, and then you prepare for the not so good years. We're still offering a price on the acres that, I mean, farmers have told me, hey, look, on $20 beans, I'm making money. I'm still making money. So, you know, our idea is if you're willing to go out there and commit that early, we try to offer you the best price that we foresee for the future, for that commitment, for that domestic soybean crop. So it is changing. I think you're seeing more, I think you'll see more forward contracting, kind of like we're doing, to use as a risk tool. Some farmers kind of use it almost like a hedge tool on us. But, you know, it's some guys will go all in and dedicate half their acres to me. Some guys all their acres because they just, you know, they just like to deal with one person and that's it. And then you have the gambling man who will give you a couple acres and then, you know, he's going to wait to get that price rise. But the market's done something different the last year and a half here, and I think it pays to do some forward contracting at this point.
Spencer, for all of you, is there a minimum volume that you will contract? So if somebody's just getting started, they want to kind of
another thing about acres is, again, it's low risk because it's not a, for us, it's not a guarantee of bushels. Obviously, you don't know what you're going to produce in March when October rolls around. We look for a minimum of 30 acres because that almost guarantees us a truckload on an average year of beans. But another thing that's positive or for the farmers on our acres contract is we promise whatever those acres produce, if you dedicate 100 acres, we will pick up all 100 acres that produces, even if it ends up being at the end a half truck. You know, we'll find another guy that can throw it in his hopper. That's one thing with a truck contract, you know, by the truckload, is if you say two trucks and that's what they'll pick up, two trucks, and then you have 500 bushel bean left on the farm, it's hard to get rid of when guys can't get full truckloads. But that is another added benefit that is different about our acreage contract than our normal spot contracts in the fall. So 30 acres would be my answer for what we're looking for, a minimum, which isn't much, but like I said, with domestic, when you're talking domestic organic, it's one truck at a time in our facility. So,
Terry, do you have a...
My answer is very similar. They're looking at it by the truckload, basically. And on the contracted side, I want to say that 10,000 bushel minimum storage, but that, don't quote me on that. Definitely, if you are interested on that side of it, come by the booth and let me get you connected with our grower pool.
Okay. Chris, do you have a...
I start off with the one truck worth of a load too, but that's more for so if we do the freight and pick it up off farm. We have guys near some of our mills up in Pennsylvania and down here on the shore that have maybe a 200 bushel dump truck or something like that. We'll absolutely take a load if you want to deliver it in. I've also done situations where guys have a half a load of corn and a half a load of wheat. I mean, split it in a hopper trailer. Everything works okay with the carrier. I mean, absolutely, we'll be open to that as long as the supply chain's okay.
Okay.
There's some guys that don't have that much storage that need to take some stuff out of the field right away. The only hesitation I have with that is make sure you meet the specs as in moisture and everything like that. And then also, if a truck needs to pull into the field and sit and wait while something's picked, that's fine too. There may be some charges involved with that, but every situation's really we're open to it. So let's just talk about it, get all the details and see what works with us. So all that happens with less than a truckload, okay, if we pick it up, is it's just a little bit more freight charge, and okay, that's just how it works out. But we're really open to anything.
Okay. Ken, how about you? Are you looking for a set number of acres when you're looking at contracts? And when do you look for contracts? And well, then I'll ask you a couple more.
Because we're new to this whole aspect, we really don't have a minimum set, because we were just experimenting really to get it grown and just learn as we go kind of thing. But if you're interested in doing it, we'll talk about just about any amount of acreage. We do have to bring in harvesting equipment, so there is kind of a minimum you want to run those machines around in, but we're pretty much open to any acreage for vegetables at this point.
So, Ken, you said you were looking at sweet peas right now and green beans. Anything else in the future that you might be looking for?
We're contemplating spinach, because it's a lot of acreage that's grown down in this area, mm-hmm, and we have a lot of requests for spinach. It's one of the more requested organic items for us. Since we do a pretty fair conventional crop of spinach, organic would seem to fit right into that. So that would be another one, yes.
Okay. All right. Steve, you want to talk a little bit about your contract, about what you would offer if somebody was interested in growing for Coleman?
I guess the one thing that distinguishes us on our contract is what we do pay. And if anybody knows people that grow chickens or grow chickens, we probably have the simplest of contracts. And that's very refreshing to me when all the years of where companies have steadily competed with different types of bonuses, different types of incentives. Bottom line with us, we have a base pay of 7.5 cents a pound. To tell you that compares, for a comparable broiler, we pay 4.35 cents a pound. So we make it very lucrative. We want a organic producer to be reimbursed very well. We want them to be the family farm. We want them to be there on the farm. So we look at that from an reimbursement standpoint. Also, it's very important to us that they stay viable, because you just don't go out every day and pick up an organic farm. We're under a three-year process, just like you are with your ground, because of pasture. So if a farm is not, can't be certified, then we have no place to put chickens for our customers. So one thing I failed to mention before, Jenny, is we do cover all costs of certifying the farm. So we're certified through Oregon TILF. So we do certify the farm. It's the grower's responsibility once certified to maintain that certificate. So.
Good. Okay. All right. Let's see. Any of you can jump in on this one. Do any of you see the possibility of the shore being a GMO-free pocket for agriculture in the future? What do you think?
I'm an optimist, so I'll say yeah.
Okay, there we go.
This area has always long been known to be, we're so close to the markets here, and the market is definitely demanding it. So I'll put my vote in for that.
I actually had an interesting conversation with a guy at a show a few weeks ago that said, since we're seeing some issues with GMO contamination in corn, especially on the organic side, is that it's becoming tough for some of these farmers to make sure that they're planted in an area that's protected against cross-pollination. Your surrounding crops are placed in the right spot, or they're far enough away to protect you from that cross-pollination. Well, it's probably going to eventually get to a point where we may actually have the conventional guys have to look at where their pollination is drifting. And I think it may be to that point that we finally see a real big turnaround, and spots or pockets like possibly the Eastern Shore mm-hmm. could go to a GMO-free. But I think that would kind of be the tipping point at that. And all that really takes is just kind of the path that the U.S. mindset seems to be on right now, with just going more all natural, being more aware of the risks with some GMOs and what they actually are, actually the science behind it, rather than just hearing, some random commercial or something online. So it would be a long process, I think, but, may I be an optimist too, I'll okay. agree.
Anybody else want to weigh in on that? Okay. All right. Let's see. We got a couple more minutes. Let me see. One question I had, what is the biggest challenge that you gentlemen hear from your growers or from your producers? Any thoughts on that one?
The biggest challenge for me right now is the fact that we are not in the acreage contracts right now. I know that is a very attractive incentive to a lot of producers, because it lays off a lot of the risk. But basically what I have to say is we're getting to that point, and once Perdue gets to that point, I think we're going to have a lot better or a real good process through it, because that way, once it gets to harvest, I'll know kind of what that volume is going to be, depending on whether a guy lives in New York, the Midwest, Eastern Shore, because different weather patterns, of course, create different yield and everything. So I'll have a much better feeling about what's going to take, how to prepare for it, how to adjust storage, and it's going to be a real smooth process. So that, combined with the volume that we take and everything like that, I think I'm really excited for what the future has to hold for that. So that's kind of the difficult part, I'd say.
Okay.
Is it what we see or our growers?
Yeah, that's either. Yeah. That's
weeds. Fun. Right. Definitely an organic. The organic farmers we were working with a guy in Muncie, Pennsylvania, just north of us, a farmer, does a pretty good amount of land. And he said, I showed up and he was running a little event with Penn State Extension. And he told the crowd, he looked out at this field going through transition, and he had some conventional guys there, and they had some big eyes. He said, "You got two options here. You can look at the weeds, or you can look at the soybeans." And the conventional guys, you know, all they could see is weeds. So that is definitely an issue, but there's more research being done on the organic farming side, on the grain side, even at the university level now. It's getting a lot more attention. You have Rodale up in Kutztown, Pennsylvania. They do a lot of work. They're a good resource. There's more info out there with the internet, of course, now for people to get their hands on and do this. Cover crops, more people are cover cropping, using crimpers. So there are means of doing it. And with the new organic farmers coming on, there's a lot of upfront costs, more, you know, you're getting back more into tilling and buying different things like a crimper. But once you buy those things, that's your upfront cost. You're done for a while. Whereas a conventional guy, I mean, he's constantly, every year you're spending money on sprays and synthetic fertilizer. It's a constant cost. It might not be as large up front, but in the long run, if you're committed, it actually pays to look at it to be a organic farmer, because you have less inputs yearly. It's just the upfront price. And then I'd say the number two complaint is the three-year transition. If you do want to go, I'm not receiving those premium prices for 3 years and dealing with the same problems such as the weeds and those sort of things on that side. And that's pretty much mostly what I hear if you're getting started looking at organic grain production.
So I work with transitioning farmers just about every day. And I always tell them, first thing, the hardest is to cross the mental barrier in your mind. And once you can cross that fence, then you can pretty much do it. And if you're a good conventional manager, you're going to be a great organic manager. I would agree that weeds is a major issue. If you are a member, we have a specialist that does nothing but set up cultivating equipment, and he's got decades of experience. And if you get him on the phone, you may never get off because he loves to talk. And then the other thing I would say, yeah, I agree, the barrier to entry, the three-year transition is pretty tough. But if you haven't put any corn in the ground, you already got almost a year under your belt if you last sprayed in June. So go organic if you're thinking.
From our perspective, I guess weed control is certainly an issue, but insect control and nutrient management is a part of this. Is the guys that are doing vegetables have to prepare well in advance their rotation and things like that to just make sure that there's enough nutrients for the crop that you're going to particularly want to put in the ground. So there's several things, but I think they're all manageable, and as long as you're looking ahead and planning ahead, it seems that guys that are familiar with vegetable production certainly know how to do that. So that would be the hurdles that we would be most concerned with.
Okay. Steve, you have?
You know, I think when it comes to poultry, no different probably what a lot of you deal with out here. It's obviously the environmental issues that we have to deal with. Stormwater management in Queen Anne's County is getting tougher. I'll tell you, Cecil County's tougher than that. So, but and then I think the other thing is that you know, obviously disease threats. You brought up the subject of AI. I can tell you that, you know, when you look across the shore, one thing we're blessed with is a broiler aged bird versus, you know, layer operations, turkey operations like what's up in Pennsylvania. So that gives us a little bit of protection. I do think it's up to every individual farm to exercise their own levels of biosecurity. I know we I think as a company have a good biosecurity program, but it's still the responsibility of the producer to put that in place and be sure it's being followed by everybody that visits the farm. So with that being said, I mean, we can get through it. AI is a very easy virus to kill. The unfortunate thing is, once you get infested with it, there's a period of time that the government won't let you do business, and that's what we have to try to avoid. So, yeah,
good. All right, gentlemen, any final thoughts? We're about out of time, so Chris?
I guess I just wanted to go into that part with the weeds. I'm glad you guys mentioned that. Of course, weeds is a big issue. Especially on what I've heard from a lot of guys, the guys that rent ground. To your landlord, I've been hearing, and
this makes a lot of sense that when your field is covered with weeds for maybe those first few years of organic production, that may not look very good to a landlord. Maybe they won't rent just for that single reason. And it all comes back to that mental barrier. You got to show that research. You got to show those stats that, weeds in the field doesn't necessarily mean that yield is nothing. You got to show the science and the figures behind it to really show people the value in it. And because that's a huge mental barrier to a lot of guys. I mean, you want clean fields. Everybody wants clean fields. You want clean fields and organic too. Having some weeds in there doesn't necessarily mean it's the end of the world. So once you can get past that and the landlord side of it too, then this thing could grow a lot quicker and a lot better.
I would just say that it's exciting for me to be in this room, to sit up here with guys from Perdue, Hanover, Coleman. I mean, it's a dream. It really is a dream to see bigger companies pushing this movement forward. And if you're in this room, you're on the right track. Organic Valley started with seven guys with a dream growing a few vegetables, and we passed $1 billion in sales last year. So this industry is growing by leaps and bounds. It doesn't seem to be letting up. And we're just here to help you and help the family farmers. So glad to be on the panel and glad to be here.
Anybody else have any? Spencer?
I want to thank Jenny again for being here today. And I look forward to talking to some of the farmers we work with. Now's a good time to get into organic. I think, like someone said earlier, it's the beginning stages of something new and great where you're going to see your highest profits. Once it becomes the norm or the reg, if it does, obviously it, not so much. I always tell guys if I had 500 acres, I can't afford it, but if I did, I would be putting it certainly into organic production, not only from a price standpoint, but also we have a soil issue in this country too that needs addressed. And one of the things that organic does is it addresses that issue with crop rotations and diversity and different things like that. So that's important to keep in mind. And also, I would say probably all of us here, but I buy soybeans, so I can certainly help you out with that, organic beans. But I'm also well connected with a lot of people who I might be able to point you in the right direction if you need help, on the agronomy side or marketing or something else. So feel free to give me a call about either or, and look forward to doing business with some of you.
Okay, good.
Excuse me. I'll just leave everybody with this. I think when you look at dealing with certifiers and on the organic side, it's been my experience that I think people see big business being organic as not being truly organic.
Yeah.
And I can tell you that I think it goes down to the level. It's still an individual farm. It's still a family farm. But there's a growing public of people out there that want organic chicken, and I feel like it's our responsibility to make whatever possible to get it to them. So you see a rising market, more interest in antibiotic-free, no antibiotics ever. And again, that's just a more informed, growing public. And I always felt like that would threaten organic. But, as I get more into it, I realize that, there's a public probably leaving antibiotic-free, moving towards organic. I feel like organic, in my opinion, is recession-proof. People's going to buy organic chicken, whether or not it's $10 a pound, $8 a pound. So, and that's their choice because they believe in it. With antibiotic free, all natural, there's a lot of debate out there what does that represent. And when you look at organic, either it's organic or it's not.
That's right.
It's straightforward. So I appreciate that part of it, and I thank everybody for giving me the opportunity to come today. Thank you.
Ken?
Well, thanks for listening. We're new to this game, certainly. We haven't been in it that long. The fact that vegetables is something new for the Eastern Shore for organic, I remember talking about it to Karen Fedor about 10 years ago, it seems like. And we were always talking around in circles about it. Is it real? Is it a fad? Is it going to stick around? And certainly in the last couple of years, as we've started to investigate it more, and had more requests. People are actually now giving us orders to want to buy it. And that's really a big indicator to us that we should be in the production side of getting as much as we can to do it. So for us, we're excited about doing it and glad to be here. And hopefully if you have questions, you know, certainly I'll be here and we can talk a little more in detail about it. But I think it's something here that's going to stick around for quite a while. And with the interest and the conversation about it everywhere, it's a good thing. So thank you very much.
Good. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much. It's been great.